Hello and greetings from Iceland. As you all know by now, eruption number 7 on the Reykjanes Peninsula started on Saturday with way more force than we have seen before, and still we don't see it come to an end. So what we have is yet another unpredictable scenario. And why am I not there? And why didn't I make this video sooner? That was also yet another unpredictable scenario. But I was stuck in bed for days with unusually bad case of flu. And I can't say how disappointed I was, since never before have I prepared so well to film an eruption that we knew that was coming. But it did occur way later than we expected. So I was 16 days in Reykjavík, waiting, almost 500 kilometers away from home, mostly driving around the Reykjanes Peninsula, filming and waiting. And when I finally gave up on waiting, I drove back to North Iceland, and that was only 2 days before the eruption started. And my real problems only started then, because the day after I got back, Friday, my brain just shut off due to the flu. And I was totally useless for days. So I missed a big part of this eruption, the first days at least, which was of course frustrating, although there were others covering this on YouTube, so there was no lack of information. And as for better news, I did shoot a lot of footage while moving around on the peninsula. Some of it will become useful today, and I have plenty of interesting videos coming soon from that trip. And I will of course do another trip to the Reykjanes Peninsula soon, so I can look at the changes, because I was filming the landscape that just went under lava last weekend in order to make the so-called before after videos. So I was at least spot on with some of the locations, and all I have to do is to drive back and get the after shots. So even though I didn't get the red stuff this time like I hoped for, I got a whole lot of important bits for the bigger picture, since I've been documenting this as a series of events. And as for this eruption and my take on it, I first want to say that it is of great concern how short the warning time has become. The startup was as if Mother Earth was cutting butter with a warm knife, since the ground is already so broken there. And eruption number 8, it will most likely give us no warning at all. And that eruption might be cooking, since it has been confirmed that land uplift has started again. But the main question now is, why isn't number 7 over and done with? And what does this mean, this new pattern we are looking at now? Shortly before the eruption started, I found an interview with Professor Magnús Tumi Guðmundsson. And I don't see him often in the media, although he is one of our top professors, and very careful when it comes to statements. So careful that the media hardly ever gets any flashy headlines from him. But he was saying last week that the next eruption, the one that just started, might turn out to be more like the first three eruptions, extending over a longer period of time, more like the first three eruptions. And today, I found another interview with him, 2 days old, and he was a bit reluctant to say if this could turn into something like the first three eruptions. But he wouldn't rule it out though, and overall we just don't know the big plan that Mother Earth has for this location. But what we know for sure is that we have almost two fully formed craters now that look a bit today like eruption number 2. Where I filmed this. So are we about to see what happened 3 times on Faradalsfjall mountain, with perhaps one crater that goes on for weeks or months? We can't say yet, so the next days will be interesting when it comes to GPS and satellite data, or if they can explain something about the magma highways under there and the traffic on them. So this eruption, number 7, it didn't make anything simpler. And let's go with the lava flow for a bit and do a damage report. Shortly before I turned back north, I was filming this little spot on the old Blue Lagoon Road. I had the feeling that I would only have this chance for so long, and the next eruption might come down the same way, and that turned out to be the case. And it has been a bit disappointing how hard it is to find good footage that shows me the big picture as I would prefer to see it, with good establishing shots from a drone. So I have to admit that I don't know if this little spot exists or it got covered, but I think so. But what we know for sure is that the Grindavík road closed again at this same location. It will be reopened soon with a new layer of fresh gravel on top of the fresh lava layer that is on top of the burned asphalt that went up in smoke in February. So this part of the road has some very interesting bit of history to it now. And the Blue Lagoon, it won't open until the road has been fixed. They say on the webpage that they will reevaluate the situation tomorrow. And further down, we have another story. And many of you might remember the February disaster when the lava took out the hot water pipeline that feeds the rest of the peninsula, serves almost 10% of all houses in Iceland. So the last weeks have been used to make a new pipeline there and protect it with gravel. And this is how it looked just a few days before the eruption, ready for the next dose of lava. And it came as close as 100 meters this time, when it stopped. I don't see this new protection very convincing, but I will look into that better later. I have more footage from several trips there that I need to compare first. But we can, however, say that luck was on our side this time. And I can also say the same about the location where the other part of the lava came down, just by Grindavík. And this was shot by the town last week. It's a video that covers the whole new lava wall, and I have the full version of this video on my little Icelandic channel and linking to it. The plan was to make a separate version for this channel, but now it looks as I will have to do it a bit differently, since we have a new landscape there now. The lava came down here, and they did what they were designed to do, or to prevent the lava to hit the town or the harbor. So it came flowing down beside this lava wall. But this lava barrier design, it left out one farmhouse there. That decision was made most likely due to the topography there. It might have been too much trouble to include this one single farm. And the landowner or this farmer had to learn about this in the TV, that the new lava barrier might flood his farm. And it is a farm that ironically bears the name Hraun, that means lava. But luckily, the farmhouse survived and also the South Coast Road, which is one of the three roads into town. But the lava wall, it has not come to a complete stop, and there are still a few lava ponds up there that might take off. So this is not fully over. Although the eruption is only like 5% of what it was when it started, or most likely not enough to push the lava further down. So this new part of the lava barrier, it proved to hold well, and the ground there can hold even more lava if the next eruption follows the same path. And we are all aware of the fact that such defenses, they can only control the lava to a certain limit. So how much time do we have? How many eruptions can we handle? And just before the eruption started, there was a lot of discussion about the results of experts who said that the inflow of magma had been reduced by half, and this scenario could come to an end late next summer. But not everyone agrees on that conclusion, so I am in no position to comment on it, at least until there are better numbers available out there from GPS and satellite data, and that will be soon. And I still think that we have a realistic chance to get the town through this with this plan that we have going on now, those lava barriers. But I'm also realistic when I say that the community will never be quite the same again, actually quite far from it. And the town is a big mess, and it hurt me even more to see it abandoned and the community scattered around Iceland than to see the other damages that we can fix in most cases. And those are clips from my last trip, last week. some of the videos that I will publish in full length soon. And I was also filming in Grindavík on November 9th. And when I come to think of it, what has happened since then, it was, in a way, the last day of the town as you knew it. So this is quite remarkable, but sad piece of history that I have been gathering. And when we start to talk to the people who lived there, this gets only worse. I feel as the Icelandic media has failed the people of Grindavík. And there are many untold stories that I've been hearing that deserve more. And I will for sure do my best in future. I'm thinking about this now because yesterday was a big day when it comes to the history of all this. Or 3 years since the first eruption started. But I started to cover this in 2020 when the first inflation event took place under Mount Thorbjörn. I had no drone footage to work with back then. I had never done a voiceover before, and when I started to browse through my private collection for pictures of Mount Thorbjörn, I came up with this one, with the mountain where it all started in the background. And for me, it has turned out to be more symbolic than back then, when I actually used it in a video. So, if I will find the time, I might use the chance to make a video that covers those first 3 years. Just a compact version to make those events easier for new viewers to understand, see the big picture. But as for now, I hope that the next days will tell us more about the magma influx into the sill. Is it decreasing or was it just wishful thinking? And in my opinion, although I might be wrong, I think it's way easier to handle a continuous eruption for months like the one that we have going on now. Rather than to have those forces ripping up the ground every now and then and throw something at us that we have not always handled. Because what we have now is something that we can control up to some limit. And like to expect, there is no expert that has all the answers. This is a major event, volcanic tectonic episode. And we had this rare chance to see it live. So even though I missed a few days, it was just a short part of this long story. And due to how sick I was and not fully recovered, I'm not driving back to the Reykjanes Peninsula the next 1 or 2 days at least. But if this eruption will go on, there is no way I will be able to hold myself back. So I'm already looking at the weather forecast. And as for those of you who have been checking out my whereabouts, thank you very much for your concern. I only opened my mailbox today. It was not the plan to disappear like this, but this was a nasty flu. And after this upload, I will try to catch up in the comment section and mailbox and such. But as for those 16 days I was waiting and filming around the Reykjanes Peninsula, I was very pleased with the outcome. In some cases I was filming clips that I would like to show to Professor Sean Wilsey. We have been planning to collaborate for some time, like he has already mentioned. There are times when I need a professional to help me to explain my footage, to add a little more depth to it. And Professor Sean, as active as he is, he can always use footage for his channel or classroom. So collaboration fits us well, since we are often working on the same subjects, but not for the same reason. So feel free to come up with ideas how I can use my footage and his knowledge to come up with something visual and educating. So this is just one of the projects that I have lined up for the future, and I will tell you more about my plans soon. But as for the next days, is this eruption just one more chapter that leaves us with only more questions? Or might my friends in Grindavík see the sun again from their old hometown? This is not getting any simpler. And with that, I'm sending you best regards from the volcano island, Iceland.